In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Brothers and sisters, let's acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. You are sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who founded all the commands of your sacred law upon love of you and of our neighbor, grant that by keeping your precepts, we may merit to attain eternal life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way and the wicked his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God who is generous in forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Near to all who call upon him and all who call upon him.
A reading from this letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me life is Christ, and death is gain. If I go on living in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. And I do not know which I shall choose. I am caught between the two. I long to depart this life and be with Christ, for that is far better. Yet that I remain in the flesh is more necessary for your benefit. Only conduct yourselves in a way worthy of the gospel of Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus told his disciples this parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out at dawn to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with them for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. Going out about 9 o'clock, the landowner saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You too go into my vineyard, and I will give you what is just." So they went off. And he went out again around noon, and around 3 o'clock, and did likewise. Going out about 5 o'clock, the landowner found others standing around and said to them, "Why do you stand here idle all day?" They answered, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You too go into my vineyard." When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Summon the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and ending with the first." When those who had started about 5 o'clock came, each received the usual daily wage. So when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also got the usual wage. And on receiving it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last ones worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who bore the day's burden and the heat." He said to them in reply, "My friend, I am not cheating you. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what is yours and go. What if I wish to give this last one the same as you? Or am I not free to do as I wish with my own money? Are you envious because I am generous? Thus the last will be first, and the first will be last." The Gospel of the Lord. I think a lot of people will agree with those first laborers that something about that whole arrangement seems a little bit unfair towards them. After all, when we're talking about physical labor in the vineyard in the Middle East, we're not talking about, you know, light labor. These are not people who are pushing paper around on a desk, taking a long coffee break. This is a hot climate. They're carrying heavy loads. They are doing very precise, very physical work. And it does seem fairly logical that they are upset about those other people who got to only show up in the evening when it's cooler, work only for an hour, barely enough time to work up a sweat, and then get the same wage. But I think the reason that they are so upset is the same reason that it feels unfair to us. That's that we're not actually thinking very realistically about what that means to be a day laborer who is waiting all day for a chance to work. When we imagine what their day was like, we think about them, you know, sitting in the marketplace in the shade, talking to their friends, relaxing, resting, having a good time. But again, these are day laborers. They only receive money to eat if they are working. Which means that those workers sitting there in the marketplace were probably not, you know, leaning back and, you know, counting their blessings about how nice it is not to have to work this day. It's a hot one, much better to sit in the shade. They spend those hours imagining the faces of their families when they had to come home and announce that there's no bread that day, that no one wanted them to work, no one needed them, and so no one paid them, and there's nothing to eat, and everyone will go home, go to sleep hungry, but hopefully the next day there'll be something. The next day they might get some food. And on top of that, they probably were trying to do everything they could to get hired. They were trying to draw people's attention. They were trying to show themselves to be particularly good and conscientious workers. They would constantly be trying to connect with someone, only to be disappointed and rejected. That must have been very dispiriting, very worrying, very just soul-crushing. I think any one of those workers, if they had a choice between not working that day or spending the day doing that difficult work in the hot sun, they would have chosen the vineyard every time, because for them that was important, while not working was terrifying. And on top of that, by working, they would be able to look back on what they did with pride. They would be able to know, they would know going home that they have made a difference, that what they did mattered, that the money they are bringing home, the bread they are bringing home, was earned by the sweat of their brows. And I think all that is even more true when we talk about our life of virtue and sin, which obviously is what Jesus is drawing us towards. Because it's easy to fall into that mindset that evil likes to try to push on us. The idea that sin is fun and virtue is hard work. And so, you know, the best thing we can do is to find out exactly how much sin we can get away with and try to maximize that while still managing to somehow turn out okay in the end. But again, I think that's a very, very wrong view of what a life of sin is truly like. Because what's really good for our happiness? Isn't greed, selfishness, cruelty? It's love. That's what we're designed for. That's where we find the greatest happiness. When I look back on my life and think about which times I was most proud, most happy, most felt like I really enjoyed it. It's not when I'm sitting by myself, selfishly and self-focusedly trying to grab everything I can. It's the times I spend with the people who are important to me, when I have done something that is kind, that is brave, that is good. I have built something important with people who are important to me. It's those achievements that really stick in my mind as those best moments. And all those things take work. Yes, it is labor in the heart, in the hot sun. It is like that work in the vineyard. It's not easy. Sometimes it is actually downright painful. But it's still good. Meanwhile, sin gives us the illusion of happiness. Sin gives us the temporary pleasures that the world promises, but nothing that lasts, nothing that's really good. When we think about people who are genuinely cruel, when we think about people who are really selfish and stingy and constantly complaining and trying to cheat people, those are not happy people. Those are not people we look at and are inspired by and aspire to become. So Jesus is inviting us to recognize that. To recognize that it is not ideal to try to live a life of dissipation and selfishness and hatred, only to convert at the last second. But rather, that it is better to live a life of love, to live a life of virtue and faith. And that the fact that he is merciful, that someone who wasn't living the right way will be able to receive God's mercy, will be able to enter into heaven along with those who have been doing the right thing all along, is not cheating anybody. God's giving the just reward for the good person. They are not having anything held back from what they are to receive. He's just being generous and giving more than is just to those who by their actions chose poorly, chose to have less happiness, less fulfillment, less goodness in their life. But in the last hour, recognized the error of their way and received God's mercy. So let's pray for our own conversion and the conversion of others all as early as possible. Because the earlier we can, all of us can, recognize that the Lord is inviting us into relationship with him, inviting us into the vineyard, the more we'll be able to live out that joyful, difficult work in the vineyard. And the better prepared we will be to enter into the heavenly reward. The Lord is generous to to all who are willing to accept his invitation. Let us not begrudge those who came later, but rather pray that they join as early as possible. And know that every hour of work in that beautiful and difficult vineyard is time well spent and much happier than an hour of sin.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now, trusting in God's great goodness and love, we turn to him, bringing forward all of our needs and petitions.
For all who proclaim the gospel with their lives, especially teachers and missionaries, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who labor in the vineyards of peace, especially national leaders and elected representatives, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who suffer and die for their faith, especially Christians in the Middle East, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who strive to end disease and suffering, especially doctors and medical researchers, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's pray that the members of this assembly mirror God's mercy in the way they care for one another. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who gather at this table, especially the sorrowful and the lonely, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Judy Carroll, Edwina Sierra, Richard Rick, and Joan McCarthy, for whom this Mass is offered today, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, we thank you for hearing us and for all the ways in which you bless us each day. And we ask you to open our hearts ever more fully to your love, and to strive to work always for the good of our soul and the good of our world. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Christ, gather us together.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive with favor, O Lord, we pray, the offerings of your people, that what they profess with devotion and faith may be theirs through these heavenly mysteries. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Sean, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse,
the blessed apostles and all the saints have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Let us pray. Graciously raise up, O Lord, those you renew with this sacrament, that we may come to possess your redemption, both in mystery and in the manner of our life, through Christ our Lord. Let us pray together the prayer to St. Michael. St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Trust in